What all we are going to cover? The high level topics. One is importance of listening. Number two, how you got to be a listener you are. Barriers between listener and speaker. Listening to ourselves. Making listening work for us. Getting others listen to you. So this particular area, getting others listen to us in that section, we will put ourselves in the other side of the table. That is, we will hold the role of a speaker and we will see as a speaker what all things we can do so that the people or the person on the other side who might not be trained listener, how their listening ability can improve. But other than that, first few sections, we will talk about the listening part. I, as a listener, what all things I should do, irrespective about whether speaker knows listening or not. From my side, as a listener, what all things I can do so that I can become a better listener. So this is the high level objective. Now, we'll start with the importance of listening. So under importance of listening, what we are going to do is, first, what is listening and what can it do for us? Number two, types of listening. Number three, how listening helps us in terms of relationship, both professional, personal. Self-awareness we'll talk about. We'll talk about the professional development and success. Listening and interpersonal power we will see. And levels of listening. Now, one thing, many of times we kind of misjudge in terms of, though in English language you have two words, listening and hearing, many of times we feel that hearing and listening are the same thing. But actually, it is not. So in a simple way, a simple word we can say, I always give this example, God has given us 2 ears. And both of them are in the more or less in the same line, though doctors or the people who are expert in anatomy, they will say the different reason altogether. But generally, what I always used to give an example that why these 2 ears are in the same line, because whatever I really don't want to listen comes in from here, goes out straight from there. That's why this is in the same line. So assumingly, we have a drop gate in between. If I want to listen, we'll block the drop gate so that whatever information is coming from one ear goes to the brain. But that's a very simple analogy. So reality is, whatever sound comes to our ear, it will become listening only when it properly goes to my brain. If it doesn't go to my brain, in that case, it's not listening. It will remain hearing. So that is the first thing we need to understand, that listening and hearing are not the same. So we all hear. Now the question is, how many of us are really listen in most of the time or ideally all the time? So to convert from hearing to listening, we need to tune our brain so that whatever we are hearing goes to our brain to process and store. In other words, we can say hearing is a physical process while listening is a psychological process, because in listening, things goes to my brain and we start understanding, get that information, get stored in the brain, and we analyze, dissect and all these things with that information. Now, next point is, what is listening and what can it do for us? Now, we often talk about the good listener, poor listener and all these things. So let's first understand that an aspect of a poor listening skill is we often try to jump into the conclusion before hearing out the other person completely. Does it happen to you? So we have not the person who is speaking has not completed what he or she is saying. In between we jump, okay, I understand, got it.
It happens many times with me, actually. I was about to say the introduction, but you already said pre-notion is one of those things where we always assume
about
is going to deliver, and we jump into conclusion saying that there's a solution for what you are going to say.
Correct.
Quite often.
Absolutely. So that is one major reason of poor listening, that jumping into the conclusion before the speaker have not completed. Now here I would like to put one disclaimer. From my personal experience of my team members or even other people also, what I have observed, some people, they have a habit of giving the context every time with very too much of details. Now, they always start from the almost like a historical age. When Babar invented India, it started from there, and they keep on going. Now, in those cases, what happens, very honestly, is we kind of get little disturbed, bored, and all this thing, and we keep on thinking, boss, come to the point, man. I mean, I'm not interested in so much of history, so much of context. So one thing what we can do is not in the first interaction, we should still, I would suggest to give a patient hearing, patient listening. But if that person is part of my team, in that case, one good thing is coach that person, that Baba, you don't need to give too much of context every time. Give the context, whatever level is required in whichever interaction. If required, feel free to ask, do you have the context? If you really need to give a long context so that the other person understands, maybe a good idea to send an email. And maybe ping him or her or call him or her before the formal or actual meeting that I have sent you an email. This is a little long context. I have given you the context so that if you may have a look at the email, so I can skip those in basic introductory context part. So we both will be on the same page. And so what happens, why I'm saying this is, it's a psychological part. The moment somebody is kept on talking, until and unless that person has a very interesting way of speaking. Some people have a very interesting way of speaking. Whether he or she is giving context or even blabbering also, we feel, oh, wow, how nicely this person is speaking, but not always. Now, if that is not the case, if the person is not a fantastic orator or speaker, in that case, after some time, our brain get cut off. So even I am genuinely interested to listen, many of times, my listening turned into hearing. So, I don't know here what this person is talking about, going on and on and on. Come on, man. So that kind of thing happens. So for that, it is a good idea, especially if this is about one of our team members, it's a good idea to coach him or her that this is how you should do. So that, ultimately, when I am speaking, I want my listener's attention. The person should be able to listen to me, not hearing. And if I keep on blabbering, in that case, from listening, any point of time, it can be turned into hearing. So that part is there. Now, second, to be a good listener, it is critical that we hear completely what the other person is saying and occasionally paraphrase what is being told. This ensures our complete understanding and also avoid any assumption or ambiguity. Again, very important factor. Especially when we are in a business meeting, either with the client or internal stakeholder, whoever it might be. Paraphrasing or proper understanding. Paraphrasing is one technique. There are multiple techniques. As Mr. Damodaran said, that he used to take notes. So these things are very important so that we ultimately, first, I feel I have understood, and then I am validating whether my understanding is correct. Now, next is drama triangle. Now, what is drama triangle? This is another socialization process. Is the drama triangle where or when individual act from not okay mode, it should have but three different types of participant: prosecutor, rescuer, and victim. Prosecutor are those who always find mistake on the other person and highlight it in a way that the other person get hurt. So any conversation, you are saying something to me, in my brain, what I am trying to do is I am trying to find fault on you. Whatever you are saying, if you say 10 sentences, I will ensure, or my objective is, out of 10 sentences, at least 6, 7, 8 sentences, I will try to find out a fault. And the moment I will get a chance, I will not talk whatever good things you have said. I will only highlight, you have said this wrong, you have said this wrong, this is nonsense, this is bullshit, etc., etc., etc. If we move a little away from the communication or listening part, people who have this kind of attitude, they never found any good thing done by people. For example, assume a situation. Our son or daughter may not be a great student in class, in study, may not be a great person in study. He or she doesn't come stand first or second in the school or in the class examination. Now, what I always do is, I always tell him or her that you are useless. Look at this person or this person's son. He always come first or come second or at least stand in the class. Now, somehow in one examination, assume he or she came third. Not first, second, but third. Now, instead of appreciating, I said, third, what is this? If you come first, then only I understand. Even if he or she comes first, you came first in a school where all the other students are mediocre. If you would have come first in the top ranking, top notch school where every student is brilliant student, great student, then I would have understood. So you're getting my point, right? So what we are trying to do is always find fault, never appreciate. What will happen because of that? The person with whom I am reacting this way, that person's moral will completely be destroyed. If it is at home front, in that case, that person will start believing, honestly, that person will start believing, I am useless. And this trauma or this kind of thing will continue for very, very, very long time, might be throughout his or her life. If it is within the organization, in our professional environment, in that case, if I keep on saying this to our team member, same thing will happen. The team member's morale will go down. He or she feel that I am useless, I am worthless. And either he or she will leave the job or ask for roll off, or at least whatever potential he or she may have to do some good job or good work will never be able to do that. Right? So we have completely destroyed the potential of the individual, being this in the drama triangle, being the prosecutor.